This is our newborn lab where we work with babies and their parents at Women and Children's Hospital. We love to interact with babies as soon as they're born or very shortly thereafter, because it gives us an opportunity to see how the brain and the mind are prepared from birth to learn language. In our studies, we look at a number of aspects of language processing in little babies, and it's really quite remarkable. So we'll be showing you two different studies. And in one of the studies, we measure the neural responses, the responses in the brain when babies are listening to one type of sound versus another.
Gracias por haber sido tan bueno, dijo. He estado atrapado aquí miserablemente desde que cayó el árbol.
This particular study was designed by Lily May, one of my PhD students, in collaboration with other students in the lab and a previous postdoc, Judith Gervain.
So what we did with the newborns is there's this great new technology that we're using. It's called near-infrared spectroscopy, and it's a neurological measure. It lets us get an idea of what sorts of brain activity are going on. And essentially how we do this is we put sensors on the baby's head, and what these sensors do is they shine light into the baby's head, and through that we get a sense of blood flow and of brain activity.
Basically, the spectrum of the light that we pick up on the sensors lets us know whether there has been change in activity in different areas of the brain. Very safe technique. It's very much like the pulse oximetry in a hospital or at a doctor's office, and they want to see how well you're oxygenating your blood, and they put this little clip on your finger and you can see the red. It's a similar technique that we use just to see how active the brain is.
And so we can get an idea of where in the brain and how in the brain the babies are excited or interested about listening to different things. And what we do is we play them sentences or segments of language, of both the familiar language and of unfamiliar language, and we look at their brain response to those two different languages.
The imp sprang straight up into the air. Mil gracias por haber sido tan bueno, dijo.
This technique can be done when babies are sleeping, because newborn babies are listening to the world around them even when they're asleep. They're learning about language, they're learning about familiar voices, and you can detect that in a sleeping newborn.
We're interested in how babies' brains respond to language just right soon after they're born, even a few hours after their birth, whether or not their brain responds similarly to all languages, whether they enter into the world ready to learn any language they're given, or whether or not their brains respond specifically to the language that they were hearing during the pregnancy. So we know that babies actually hear quite well during the pregnancy, especially during the last 3 months. Their mother's voice is very loud, and they can pick up on a lot of things about language during the pregnancy. We know that they can remember the patterns of stories that they've heard during the pregnancy after they're born, and we know that they tend to prefer the rhythm of their mother's language after they're born. So what we're interested in this study is how their brain responds to this language, whether or not their brain is responding more to the mother's language, to the rhythm and the structure and the sounds of their mother's language, or whether or not their brain is going to respond similarly to both that language and to unfamiliar languages. So we're going to put one sensor over the right side of his head and one sensor over the left side of his head, and we're going to be monitoring his brain activity to different sounds, different languages. And so one of these sensors will get an idea of what's going on the right side of his brain, and the other one will get an idea of what's going on the left side of his brain. I'm just going to check on the machine to make sure we've got good activation. So what's going to happen is I'm just going to play different languages. So we're going to hear English and we're going to hear Spanish, and the whole time on this machine we're going to be monitoring what's going on in his brain. Essentially, we think babies know a lot about the rhythm of language when they're born. They don't know that much about sounds of language, but the rhythm is really important.
The imp sprang straight up into the air, joyfully twirling his tail.
Yes, so you guys hear that's different. I got the Spanish going on. So we're looking to see whether or not, even though he's just 2 days old, his brain can tell the difference between those languages.
Pero, ¿sabes una cosa? Eres un inútil.
this second study, we're going to look at very different things using a very different procedure. Rather than testing how the brain responds to language itself, we're going to look at how babies, even newborn babies, respond to the particular attributes of language. And here, what you're going to be seeing is a baby listening to two different vowels, E and U. And what we want to know is if babies can hear the difference between those two vowels. And what we've shown in previous work, and a lot of other people have shown as well, is that at birth, babies seem ready to learn the sound system of any of the world's languages. They discriminate the consonants, like ba and da. They discriminate vowels, like ba and bo. And here we're looking at two vowels, e and u. We're also looking at whether the movements the baby makes while listening influence the way that they hear. Rather than just measuring what the brain does when the baby's passively listening, here the baby has to make a response themselves. So we use a procedure called high amplitude sucking. And we give the baby an opportunity to suck on a pacifier that's connected to a computer, and every time the baby gives a suck that's a strong suck for them, they get to hear a sound.
E. E.
So as he's sucking, it changes the pressure inside of the soother. When he stops, the sound will stop too.
E.
He's making that happen.
And this shows that even a newborn baby will change their behavior in order to hear or see something. What's really neat about this procedure in comparison to the last one is that whereas in the last one the baby could be asleep, here the baby needs to be awake and needs to be in this state that we call quiet alert. In that period is when a baby is most able to learn. So we need them in that state in our procedure, but mothers and fathers can know that when they are able to make their baby comfortable, they're fed, they're clothed, they're feeling safe, that they can get into that quiet alert state, and that's when they learn about the world around them.
What we're researching with four-month-old babies in this lab is how they're learning about categories in their world. And so something that we're really interested in looking at is what they're doing with the language that they're hearing around them before they start learning words. And so this is before the first year of life. They're learning lots about the things that they see in the world and sort of how that interacts with the things that they're hearing in the world. And what we're trying to figure out is whether or not they're picking up relationships between these two forms of information before they're actually learning labels for things. So one of the challenges in infant research is devising ways to figure out what babies know without them having to say anything to us, because when you're dealing with preverbal infants and even older infants, it's hard for them to communicate these things. So what we do is we actually measure looking time, and what we're doing is we're showing them images and have sounds paired with them, and we measure how long they look at these images.
Code. Neep. Neep.
So by measuring their looking time across the study itself, we can learn about whether or not they're becoming more interested in the stimuli, so they might look longer in those cases. They might become bored of the stimuli, which they would decrease their looking time or, you know, completely lose their attention. And if we, at the end of the study, present a brand new stimulus, we actually expect an increase in looking time. So it's something brand new and they're like, oh, I've never seen that before, I've never heard that before.